thank you for joining us for this informative American Institute of Chemical Engineers webinar, Transport Phenomena, Heat Transfer. Our speaker is Dr. David Foster. He spent over 30 years as industrial scientist engineer at Eastman Kodak Company while also teaching fundamental transport phenomena courses at the undergraduate and graduate level at the University of Rochester for the past 14 years.
The three modes of energy transfer that we're going to discuss today are conduction, convection, and radiation. Conduction, we have no motion of matter. It's really a molecular interaction, and pure metals are the best conductors. And they are the best conductors because they have free electrons available to them. Convection, we're going to define as an energy exchange between a surface and an adjacent fluid. And I'm going to talk pretty deeply about forced and free convection. Forced convection as a function of flow past the surface with a fan or a pump. And then we're going to talk very briefly about radiation, where no medium is required. And it's really a maximum when the surface are separated by a perfect vacuum. Let's begin with Fourier's law. Fourier's law is fundamental to any heat transfer process. We have fundamentally a heat transfer rate in the x direction divided by the area normal to the direction of the heat flow. And that ratio is sometimes termed a heat flux in the x direction. This being equal to the negative, meaning that the heat flow is in the direction negative to the temperature gradient. And then we have the thermal conductivity and then the temperature gradient. And here I've got temperature in the x direction. In the equation at the bottom, you'll notice that I've got a much more general equation. Most of the time, we talk about it as Fourier's rate equation, or sometimes you'll see it talked about as Fourier's first law of heat conduction, where the heat flux is proportional to a temperature gradient. And I've got it here as the del operator so that I can talk about it not only as an x, y, and z component, but I can also term it as rectangular, cylindrical, and spherical coordinates. We need to think about thermal conductivity, and we need to think about it very carefully because it's inherent to what we want to understand. Thermal conductivity fundamentally is going to be independent of the direction of the equation. And Fourier's law is going to apply to isotropic or continuous mediums only. So if I've got a medium that is not continuous, I need to break Fourier's law up into different pieces. And we'll talk about that in a moment. It's primarily a function of temperature, and I like to equate it to being a term similar to viscosity. Viscosity, as we all know, we warm up maple syrup and it flows a lot easier than when it's cold. Thermal conductivity, although not something that we can visualize perhaps as well as viscosity, has the same kind of properties. The two equations that are most common for gases in this kind of an area to determine the thermal conductivity are these two equations pictured here. The first for a monoatomic gas and the second is Chapman's equation. Both of them contain parameters that can be looked up very easily, everywhere from Boltzmann's constant to the collision diameter. These terms are available in various books like Perry's Handbook, if you're an old guy like me, or on the internet if you're someone who's a lot younger and has never even heard of Perry's Handbook. All right, we need to talk about thermal conductivity in the liquid and the solid phases, because this is where most of our work is going to be. Some of us deal with gases, but a lot of times we're going to look at liquids and solids. Unfortunately, there's not a simplified equation for liquid phases like there is for gas phases. In fact, there's no universally accurate mathematical model that currently exists. There are empirical models that are out there. If you search the literature, you'll find that people have come up with some nice empirical models that they use. However, they're very specific to very specific systems. So necessity of understanding what your thermal conductivity is in your system is going to be paramount. Solid phases are very similar, and most solids of interest have been evaluated, which is very fortunate. The solid phase thermal conductivity is certainly a result of molecular interactions in a free electron. Let's immediately do an example. If I've got a styrofoam freezer in a refrigerator that has an area of a meter squared being used to cool food, and I want to know what thickness of styrofoam insulation that I need to limit the heat loss to 400 watts. If the inner and outer surface temperatures are minus 10 and 33 degrees centigrade, respectively. This is a very nice example to illustrate Fourier's law. And we have dT over dx that we translate into being delta T, or the change in temperature, divided by the length that we want to solve for. We have the conductivity measurement, and we have the area. And Q, in this case, is going to be the heat loss that we're going to be able to tolerate in our system. Rearranging this equation, solving for L, we find out that our styrofoam insulation has got to be about 3.23 centimeters. One other note that I just want to make is that this styrofoam number for insulation, the K value is available in the literature. So like I mentioned a minute ago, many values for solids are available in the literature. They're easily looked up. So we need to have about 3.23 centimeters in order to maintain that 400 watts of heat loss.